Morning, everybody. It is an honor and a true privilege to be here this morning. My name is Derek Hopperton, my wife Whitney. We have lived in Louisville now for almost 11 years, and so we've known Terry Lee and Abby for about 7 years now. But I was born and raised in this area. I was born in Florence, Kentucky, just across the river. Spent my days at Simon Kenton High School, my summers at Kings Island, which was amazing. I spent my fall and winter cheering on the Bengals, which not always as amazing, but hooday all the way, never ending, never dying. I tell people there are only diehard Bengals fans, because otherwise they wouldn't be Bengals fans. So, but it is still in my blood. You can ask my wife, Sundays are Bengals days. So it's still Cincinnati in my heart. But this city is amazing. And I do want to say, as someone, again, who's known them 4 years before the Oaks even existed, your pastor and his wife are amazing. Just being in Louisville, a seminary town, and leading in our local church, Whitney and I have had the opportunity to really see, I was trying to count, over 20, maybe close to 30 couples from seminary that have come and went to plant churches or work in churches. And from that experience over the last 10 years, please trust me, y'all got some of the good ones right here. I mean that with all my heart. All my heart. Especially Abby. And anything, you know, after knowing Terry Lee and Abby for, you know, 4 years in Louisville, anything you like about him, he learned from me. Anything you don't like, he must have learned in Florida. But it really is an honor to be here for so many reasons. It really is an honor to be here to, first and foremost, before, above and beyond anything else, to experience the Lord together this morning. I love the songs we're singing, the scriptures shared. The theme this morning really is just the bigness of God. And what we do when we worship every week, whether it's in Louisville, Cincinnati, wherever, when you're worshiping with others, one of the main roles that the Lord has designed us to do is to reorient ourselves to look to Him. We have a tendency as human beings, the longer we go without worshiping, the longer we go without being in His Word, we tend to inflate ourselves. And as we go throughout our days and weeks, we become bigger and bigger and bigger. And that's not good. We need to constantly reorient ourselves to the bigness, to the majesty of God. And so today in Isaiah 37, if you want to go ahead and turn there, if you go to the middle of your Bible and a little bit to the right, you'll get close. Isaiah chapter 37. That's what we're going to focus on today. The bigness of God. The strength, the power, the majesty of God. And I'm going to give you the answer before the test, all right? You know, a lot of times we wait for the application. All right, we hear it, hear it, hear it. How can we apply this? Preacher, well, I'm going to tell you right now, because here's what I want us to do. Today is going to be a really cool story. I love the series that we're going through this summer, which is stories, Old Testament stories, which is, man, I love the Old Testament. And when Terry Lee said, hey, we also would like, you know, maybe some stories that aren't as well known. Oh, man, I got goosebumps. And my wife knows me. She said, you're not doing the Sennacherib story, are you? I said, oh, yes, I am. This story is awesome. But most importantly, it's going to reveal the bigness of God. So the application is this. We need to leave here, every single one of us, including myself. Because y'all, I don't know about you, I've got problems. You know what I'm saying? I've got things in life. I'm my own problem. Life happens. We got 3 kids. We're trying to raise in this crazy world. Oh, we need a big God. So as we read this story, I want you to just think 2 things as we read through it. 1, who is God? And 2, who am I? And as we read through, we're going to see a few main characters that you're going to identify with. So as we journey together, let's do that, all right? But first, let's go to the Lord in prayer, all right? Let's pray. God, I thank you so much for the opportunity to gather to worship you. Lord, the God of heaven and earth, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. And Lord, so often we try to put ourselves on the throne of our own lives. And it may seem good at first, but Lord, it always leads us down the same path to destruction. And so God, this morning, help each of us. wherever we are in our faith journey this morning, in our life journey, help us today to hear from you in your word, which you say is breathed out by you. It is living and active. It is like a sword that pierces our hearts, Lord. Do that this morning. It's in your name we pray. Amen. About 15 years ago, a Minneapolis couple decided to go to Florida to thaw out during an icy winter. They planned to stay at the same hotel where they spent their honeymoon 20 years earlier. But because they were both busy professionals, it was difficult to coordinate their schedules. So they planned for the husband to leave Minneapolis a few days before to go to Florida, and then the next day the wife would come down. So the husband gets to Florida, checks into the hotel. There was a laptop in his room, 15 years ago. There's a laptop in his room. So he decided to sit down and send an email to his wife. However, he accidentally leaves out a letter and, without realizing his error, sends the email. Meanwhile, in Houston, a widow just returned home from her husband's funeral. He was a minister who had a heart attack and was called home to glory. Expecting messages from family and friends, the widow decides to check her email. After reading the first message, she screams and faints. The widow's son rushes in the room, found his mother on the floor, and saw the computer screen, which read, "To my loving wife. Subject, I have arrived. I bet you're surprised to hear from me. They have computers here now, and you're allowed to send emails to your loved ones. I've just arrived and have been checked in, and I've noticed that everything is prepared for your arrival tomorrow. Looking forward to seeing you then. P.S. It sure is hot down here." That's not a true story, but I hope it's not anyway. But if that illustrates anything, it's the dangers of mistaken identity, right? Kind of like when you're texting, and maybe you're texting a few different people, and you send the right message to the wrong person. Who's done that? Yeah, anyone texting a spouse or a significant other and text your boss instead? Yo, that's dangerous right there, right? You're going back and forth, and you realize, uh-oh, mistaken identity. And not to be trite, but just kind of setting us up this morning, again, not to seem silly or trite, but I wonder how often or how many of us right here in this room have a little bit of a mistaken identity issue when it comes to God. A recent study by the University of North Carolina and Notre Dame, it was a joint study, they interviewed thousands of evangelical Christians in the United States between the ages of 15 and 25. Evangelical Christians, those who identify as Christ followers, about 2,000 15 to 25 year olds. And you know what they found? They just basically surveyed and said, what are your basic beliefs? And most of them who identify as Christians, here's what these researchers found. They found that all across the board, 85-something percent basically believed in a God like this. A God who's wise and loving, who wants us to live good and happy lives, wants us to treat others well, and he's always there for us if we need him. And that's it. Very few mentions of Jesus specifically, very few mentions of a cross, of a resurrection, of even a Bible, but it's those things they listed. And these researchers, not even Christian, these researchers were like, there's really a kind of an alternate religion that most Americans believe in. They don't call it this, but as the researchers, they kind of said, it's so strikingly similar across the board that it's almost its own religion. And they called it moralistic therapeutic deism. Moralistic therapeutic deism. That most people, deism, they believe in a God, one God. Moralistic, they want them to lead good moral lives. Therapeutic, he's there when you need him. That's it. And y'all, I'm sorry, but that God, that moralistic therapeutic deism God, is small. That God is weak. That God is really not going to help anybody. That God is not going to really guide anyone into right living. That God is no God at all. And I wonder how many of us in our daily lives maybe tend to gravitate towards that. I know I do sometimes. As painful it is to say, I know I kind of drift into that, because as I said before, as we go through our days and weeks, the bigger we get, the smaller God gets. And he turns into that nice old grandpa in a rocking chair. Yeah, he knows what he's talking about, but he's really only there when we really need help. He's not the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, as we're going to see in Isaiah. So let's look at Isaiah. We're mainly going to be in chapter 37, but I want to set up a little bit from chapter 36. We have a tale of two kings this morning. A tale of two kings. Let's just dive in and see what God's word has for us this morning. Chapter 36, verse 1. Just going to read a few verses here to set up the context. In the 14th year of King Hezekiah, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came up against all the fortified cities of Judah and took them. And the king of Assyria, Sennacherib, sent the Rabshakeh from Lachish to King Hezekiah, Jerusalem, with a great army. And he stood by the conduit of the upper pool on the highway to the washer's field. And there came out to him Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, who was over the household, and Shebna, the secretary, and Joah, the son of Asaph, the recorder. All right, so you can go to that next slide. We have two kings here. First, we have King Hezekiah of Judah. All right? You can see it's kind of a big map of the ancient Near East at this time. Right there is Israel. So this is kind of the world of the Old Testament, really. And as you see, way over here, we have Assyria, which is like modern-day Iraq. So this is kind of the setting of our story. And as you see here, in the 14th year of King Hezekiah, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came up against all the fortified cities of Judah and took them. This is the time around 700 BC where the kingdom of Israel is split into two. There's been like a civil war. It's been split. The northern kingdom, Israel, which is was changed to Samaria, then the southern kingdom of Judah. So that's where we find King Hezekiah, king of Judah in the city of Jerusalem, and now he's got this king of Assyria coming down against him. So you had to put an arrow there because in the context of the whole region, Israel is really small. Now, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, at this time, Assyria is conquering the world. Sennacherib is really not even a king, he's an emperor. He's the kind of leader that has kings under him, you know what I'm saying? So he is conquering the world. This next map, look at this one. This next map shows all that Sennacherib had conquered. So go back to the last slide for me. You see the whole region? Now look at this next one. Here's where Sennacherib owns now. Pretty much everything. And there's the arrow again. Notice, where is Israel? Where's Jerusalem? It's right in the middle of it. It's surrounded. And Sennacherib, town after town after town, city after city, is falling. 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 There's archaeology. This is awesome. There's a city of Lachish that we'll read about in a second. Archaeologists have found it. They're digging it up now. And you know what they found? Huge walls smashed to the ground. They're finding arrowheads from arrows all in the dirt. And you know where they trace the arrowheads to? From other archaeological digs? Assyria. I mean, this is history, all right? This is happening. This king is dominating everything. Next slide. And so here's what's happening right now. Historians have found, again, excavations that prove that 701 BC, Sennacherib is now coming all, he's already conquered the northern kingdom, and now he's marched through, he's conquering town after town, and now he's swinging around and he's surrounded Jerusalem where King Hezekiah is. And we see in chapter 36, I'll kind of summarize what happens. Sennacherib sends the Rabshakeh, or you mean your translation may just say, you know, his chief officer. That's basically what it means. It's Sennacherib's second-hand man. See, when you're a king like Sennacherib, you don't have to go and do the hard work. You just send the guy. So the Rabshakeh comes out, and he starts taunting Hezekiah and Israel. He said, come on out. What are you waiting for? He even tries to bet with them. Hey, Hezekiah, you know, we'll even give you 2,000 horses. If you can have enough soldiers to ride them, and you can use them against us. Will that help? He's being sarcastic, and he's taunting them over and over, and then he starts sending propaganda. They start sending letters to the people saying, hey, we've got y'all surrounded, and if you give up your king, then, you know, you might live. Otherwise, we're going to trap you in the city. And he even says, chapter 36 and verse 12, he's like, After a while, you're all going to run out of food. You're going to be eating your own dung. You're going to be drinking your own urine. That's what the Rabshakeh's saying. So all the people of Jerusalem, they said, no, we believe in God. You don't have a chance, man. Bring it on. You think that's what they're thinking? No, all of a sudden, they start whispering. They start wondering. They're tearing their clothes. Because they look and say, look, I mean, we're at one city, and this guy's conquered the world. What are we doing here? And now we come to chapter 37. We're going to see where the story really picks up. I told you the application is going to come. It's going to weave in and out. You're facing a battle today. You're facing a war in your life today, maybe from different angles. It may be internal, anxiety, depression, just stress. It may be external, conflict, relationships, jobs, finances, whatever it is. We've got these wars, and this is huge to see here, that we have to know who our God is. So let's dive in, chapter 37. The messengers from Hezekiah report back to Hezekiah all that Sennacherib and his officers, all the taunting and the threats. They're surrounded by this army. 37 verse 1. As soon as King Hezekiah heard it, he tore his clothes and covered himself with sackcloth and went into the house of the Lord. Let's stop right there. Good move or bad move for Hezekiah? Yeah, we know it's a good move, but in that moment, you're a king, you got an army, as small as it might be, you're surrounded by an army, people are freaking out. King Hezekiah, it's on, they're here, they're going to fight, they're going to surround us, and they're going to drown out our food supply, and who knows, they might even start attacking. And so King Hezekiah, think about that moment, you're tempted to rely on your own resources, you're tempted to rely on your own strength, you're tempted to rely on the things you know, but what does Hezekiah do? He tears his clothes. I mean, it's a sign of weeping. It's a sign of mourning, a sign of distress. So it's not that he's not feeling it, but what does he do? He covers himself and he goes into the house of the Lord. And he sent Eliakim, who was over the household, and Shebna, his secretary, and the senior priest, covered in sackcloth, to the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos. And they said to him, to Isaiah, thus says Hezekiah, this is a day of distress, of rebuke, and of disgrace. Children have come to the point of birth, and there's no strength to bring them forth. It may be that the Lord your God will hear the words of the Rabshakeh, whom his master, the king of Assyria, has sent to mock the living God, and will rebuke the words that the Lord your God has heard. Therefore, lift up your prayer for the remnant that is left. So they go to Isaiah. And they say, petition the Lord for us. Petition this God. And here's what Isaiah says. When the servants of King Hezekiah came to Isaiah, Isaiah said to them, say to your master, to Hezekiah, thus says the Lord, do not be afraid because of the words you have heard, with which the young men of the king of Assyria have reviled me. Behold, I will put a spirit in him, so that he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land, and I will make him fall by the sword in his own land. Big God moment right here. How does God reply? God doesn't reply, don't worry, you've got tools, believe in yourself, you all can handle it. God says, no, don't worry. Why? Because I'm intervening. I'm intervening. I am going to take care of this. I'm the sovereign king. Don't listen to this conqueror, as strong and mighty as he is. Listen to me. I have power over him, not only here, but where? Not only I have power over him here, I'm driving him away, but even in his own land, thousands of miles away, I'm going to take care of him. Like, I've got this, all of this, more than you can even imagine. So here's what happens next. Verse 8. The Rabshakeh returns and found the king of Assyria fighting against Libna, for he had heard that the king had left Lachish. That's the town I told you about, the excavating. It's fascinating if you want to Google it. Now, the king heard concerning Tirhakah, king of Cush, that's a guy from Egypt. He has set out to fight against you. And when he heard it, Sennacherib sent messengers to Hezekiah, saying, So here's further taunts. This is directly from the emperor, from Sennacherib to Hezekiah. Thus shall you speak to Hezekiah, king of Judah. Do not let your God in whom you trust deceive you by promising that Jerusalem will not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Behold, you have heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all lands, devoting them to destruction. And shall you be delivered? Listen to this. Have the gods of the nations delivered them? The nations that my fathers destroyed, Gozan, Haran, Rezeph, and the people of Eden who were in Telasser? Where is the king of Hamath, the king of Arpad, the king of the city of Sepharvaim, the king of Hena, or the king of Iva? So what's Sennacherib saying? Pray to your God. I mean, you know, all those other guys did that too, and look what happened to them. Like, where's the king of Iva? He's dead. He prayed to his God. I conquered him. Over. Town after town, city after city, fortress after fortress. Sennacherib's like, I've been through this before, but this is my show. Those gods didn't deliver them. Why are you any different? Here's the turning point. Right here. This is the moment Hezekiah wins. Not on the surface, but in reality, this is where he wins. And in our battles, this is where we win. See, Hezekiah is not having it easy, is he? God doesn't promise easy. He doesn't promise flat, smooth. In fact, often the opposite, but this is where God reveals himself. Hezekiah hears this taunting. He's surrounded by this world-dominating army with this man who calls himself a god. And here's what Hezekiah does. Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. I just love this picture right here. If you read through 1 and 2 Kings, you'll notice king after king after king in their little stories. And with every single one, God's word basically labels them good king, bad king. Evil, righteous, everyone. Hezekiah is one of the few that's labeled good king. Now, he makes mistakes. Kind of reminds you of David. He makes some really dumb mistakes. But this right here is going to show you what's really in his heart. I hope it's a mirror for us to kind of analyze where our own hearts are. Hezekiah receives this letter, the most traumatizing letter. I mean, his life is over, his kingdom's over. What does he do? Once again, he goes into the house of the Lord. He's holding the letter from the king. And he goes before the Lord, and what does he do? He drops the letter before the Lord and basically is just like, God, do you see this, right? Like, I know who you are. These people know who you are. I know your promises. I know we're your people. You promised that there would always be a king on the throne of Jerusalem. And yet here we are threatened. What are you going to do? I mean, it's not that he's challenging God, but he's saying, look, God, like, I know you. Like, this is your fight right here. It's like the WWE. He's tagging out. Hezekiah, he's out, right? If you're in a WWE ring, yeah, I know it's kind of fake, but I don't be body slammed by anybody, right? And I'm looking, and there's like Hulk Hogan back there. I'm tagging that guy in. Let him take care of it. That's what Hezekiah does. He's like, I'm backing out. I'm tagging God in. The Lord, what are you going to do with this? Verse 15, Hezekiah prayed to the Lord. And listen to this prayer. This is his response to the taunting of Sennacherib. Verse 16, O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, enthroned above the cherubim, you are the God. You alone of all the kingdoms of the earth. You have made heaven and earth. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see. Hear all the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to mock the living God. Truly, O Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste all the nations in their lands. And they cast their gods into the fire, for they were no gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore they were destroyed. So now, O Lord our God, save us from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you alone are Lord. If you read about Hezekiah, he does some dumb stuff, but man, then right there, his heart is stitched together with the Lord's. Hezekiah is not petitioning, Lord, we're such good people. Like, they're not. Lord, I'm such a good king. He's not really. I mean, he's a sinner, right? Lord, like, don't save us on account of any of us. Save us for you and your glory. There's a big God moment right here. Hezekiah puts the situation in God's hands and says, Lord, he's challenging you and your glory. And here's another shift in the story. Verse 21. Then Isaiah, the son of Amos, sent Hezekiah, saying, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, because you have prayed to me concerning Sennacherib, king of Assyria, this is the word the Lord has spoken concerning him. It's subtle, but what's happened here? I kind of tricked y'all, okay? Sorry. The tale of two kings isn't really Hezekiah and Sennacherib. It's shifted now. The real tale of two kings is Sennacherib, king of Assyria, and Yahweh, king of kings. Hezekiah has won by removing himself and giving the fight over to the Lord. If that's not a life lesson for you, I don't know what is. He steps back. He makes himself small. He's a king, and he makes himself small so the king can step in. And so now the story really is Sennacherib, king of the physical earth, and God, king of the heavens and earth. What do you think is going to happen? God, we'll summarize this a little bit. God speaks, and now God is speaking to Sennacherib directly. And look at verse 26. This is God to Sennacherib. Have you not heard that I determined it long ago? I planned from days of old what I now bring to pass, that you, Sennacherib, should make fortified cities crash into heaps and ruins. God's saying, I let you do that. I'm the one that gave you the strength to do that, while their inhabitants, shorn of strength, are dismayed and confounded, and have become like plants of the field, like tender grass, like grass on the housetops, blighted before it's grown. Listen to what God says to Sennacherib. I know you're sitting down, and you're going out and coming in, and you're raging against me, because you have raged against me, and your complacency has come to my ears. I will put my hook into your nose and my bit into your mouth, and I will turn you back on the way by which you came. Woo! God's like, you have all these soldiers on horses to conquer. I'm going to treat you like my horse. I'm going to hook you in the nose, and I'm going to drag you where I want you to go. That's how this relationship works in Sennacherib, right? I'm putting you in your place here. And here's what happens. This is awesome. And now the Lord is talking to Jerusalem, to Hezekiah, to his people. And this shall be the sign for you, my people. This year you shall eat what grows of itself, and in the second year what springs from that. Then in the third year sow and reap and plant vineyards and eat their fruit. And the surviving remnant of the house of Judah shall again take root downward and bear fruit upward. For out of Jerusalem shall go a remnant, and out of Mount Zion a band of survivors. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. We've seen God's passion, God's zeal, God's fervor, his fire for his glory. But God is loving and kind, and now he has joined his glory with the preservation of his people. God says, My fervor, my passion will save you. You're not going to be destroyed like these other towns. In a year, you're going to have a new harvest. I'm going to protect you. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Now we're reaching the conclusion. Verse 33. Therefore, thus says the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city, or shoot an arrow there, or come before it with a shield, or cast up a siege mount against it. By the way that he came, by the same he shall return, and he shall not come into the city, declares the Lord. For I will defend this city to save it, for my own sake, and for the sake of my servant David, for my glory and the glory of my covenant people, who through David I've promised to be my people. For I will defend this city to save it for my own sake and for the sake of my servant David. And an angel of the Lord went out and struck down 185,000 in the camp of the Assyrians. And when people arose early in the morning, behold, these were all dead bodies. Then Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed and returned home and lived at Nineveh. But remember what God said was going to happen? And he was worshiping in the house of Nisroch, his god. Adrammelech and Sherezer, his own sons, struck him down with the sword. And after they escaped to the land of Ararat, Esarhaddon, his son, reigned in his place. Angel of the Lord striking down. What does that remind you of? Think of when the Israelites were enslaved in Egypt and there was no hope and this great king was over them. God sends them out. They're trapped at the Red Sea. The Pharaoh's coming back for them. And God says, just rest. I will defend you. Just be silent. I will defend you. And here we see this again. God saving his people from judgment. We have this tale of two kings. Yeah, we have Hezekiah and Sennacherib. Yeah, we see ourselves in Hezekiah, hopefully, you know, or at least he's one that we should look to. Humility instead of pride. Looking to the Lord instead of self. But as the story goes, it kind of turns to where it's about God the king and Sennacherib the king. And believe it or not, that's the comparison I want us to make this morning. The Bible says we are much more like Sennacherib than Hezekiah. In fact, the Bible says pretty clearly all of us are a bunch of little Sennacheribs. We are kings of our own world. We sit on the throne of our own hearts. We want what we want. Yeah, we may call upon this God or this idol or this idol, but it's really to get what we want. And we're here trying to conquer this little tiny piece of earth, this little tiny life we have. We're trying to rule. We're the center of the universe. Full of pride. Full of whatever tools and gifts we have in and of ourselves. We're our own little kings and queens. And God steps in and shows us who the real king is. God even came to this earth, did he not? Think about this for a second. God comes physically to this earth, the true king. And how does he live his life? As a servant. He lives in service and love to others. And here we are trying to be our own little Sennacheribs. The Bible even goes further. It says that, just like Sennacherib, but Ephesians 2 says that we are all dead in our sins. We are all dead in our sins. Like slaves walking according to the ways of this world. Living for ourselves. Trying to build our own kingdoms. Ephesians 2 goes on and says, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, God sent his son Jesus Christ to pay the price for our sins, to die on the cross. He takes all the Sennacheribness that is full in our hearts. He takes it upon himself. The God who once struck down and sent away Sennacherib now takes that evil upon himself to save us. Through judgment brings us salvation. That's what he does in Isaiah 37. That's what he does in Exodus. That's what he does throughout the scriptures. God saves his people from judgment. All of that pointing to the salvation that Christ brings on the cross. So I'm about to close, but I kind of have two prayers this morning. My prayer for those of you who are Christ followers, you surrendered your life to Christ, you know him, you walk with him. My prayer for you, my prayer for me, we still fight that tendency. Every day we wake up, we've got a little Sennacherib in us, we need to kind of stand down. We're constantly fighting it. The Bible calls this the flesh, the sinful nature. But keep fighting that. Stay in God's word. Stay in worship. Stay in community with your church. War against that every day. Be that Hezekiah. Yes, mistakes are going to happen, but in your heart, Lord, have that big God mentality. My prayer for those of you that maybe aren't quite following Christ, maybe you're very anti-Christ this morning, you're very against him and his message, or maybe you're just wrestling and you're close, you haven't quite done that yet, realize that you're like Sennacherib. And God is the same God. He is holy. He's passionate for his own glory, for his own kingdom. And yet, in love, he invites you to be adopted as a son or daughter. Let's pray together. God, I thank you so much for your word. God, if we really believe you are who you say you are, oh, Lord, imagine on a daily basis, Lord, if we knew you for who you are, who you reveal yourself to be in your word, like in stories like this in Isaiah 37, Lord, how would that really change our daily walk? How much more time will we spend in prayer knowing we have access to you, the King of Glory? How much stronger will we fight against sin and temptation knowing that you and your strength are what gives us the victory and not our own? God, for those Christ followers in here this morning, Lord, draw us to yourself. Let us be people who are in your word every single day to constantly deflate ourselves and to magnify you, to see you for who you are, your power and your glory. Lord, for those in here who may not know you as Lord and Savior, Lord, our prayer this morning is that they would repent, they would turn from the sin in their hearts. And like Hezekiah, Lord, just to step out and to surrender and let you step in to bring redemption, to bring salvation, to bring victory. It's in your awesome name we pray. Amen.